Okay, this interview is being conducted for the Veterans History Project for the Library of Congress. The veteran's name is George Mitchell. He was born March 19th, 1924. He served in World War II in Korea. He achieved the rank of major. We are recording this on October 12th, 2015. I am Tatum Koval, and I am conducting the interview. There is no relation. All right, George Mitchell, where were you raised?
Where I was raised in the prairies of Minnesota.
All right. What part of Minnesota?
Almost into Iowa.
Okay.
Southern Minnesota, in a little farming community of 500 or 600 people.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. What was it like? What was it like being raised there? Did you work on the prairies, or?
Yeah, I worked there. Everybody worked. Uh-huh. It was. We got jobs when we were 8 years old.
Wow.
Yeah, and it was. I thought it was the greatest place in the world.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Yeah, I couldn't wait to get back when I got out of the service.
Mm-hmm. Did you have any siblings?
None.
None. Okay.
Unfortunately. Mm-hmm. My mother had had a couple of miscarriages.
Okay.
So I was just lucky to arrive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Definitely. Wow. So you went to high school then in Minnesota? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And did you finish high school before you went to the war?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Certainly. I was a high school student. And
yeah.
In the class of 35.
Wow. What was your favorite subject that you learned about?
I mean, I guess maybe it'd be history or English.
Mm-hmm.
I would say probably history.
Okay.
We share that.
Yeah, definitely. Did you play any sports in high school?
I did. I was a football player and a baseball player.
Wow.
But, you know, in a little school, mm-hmm. we only had 22 people on the football team.
Wow.
The squad.
Yeah.
And yes, I played 3 years of football and 3 years of baseball.
Wow.
And I won my letter as a sophomore, and I weighed 118 pounds.
And how tall were you back then?
Oh, I don't know, about 5'7".
Wow.
And I was excited when I got my letter.
Yeah. Wow. Wow. That's great.
The coach put me in against New Ulm Catholic High School, mm-hmm. and in a snowstorm. And just before the halftime, he said, "Mitchell, get in there." And I knew I had to have one more quarter, and that was the last game of the season.
Uh-huh.
And I almost did cartwheels going out to the field.
Just so excited.
Yeah.
Wow.
I can't say I was any star, but mm-hmm. but I participated.
Yeah. Did you have hopes to play in college one day?
No. I weighed 150 pounds when I graduated, but
okay.
I knew my limits.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then I had to go in the Army.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had 1 year of college then, and then into the Army.
So how old were you when you went into the Army?
I was 19.
19 years old? Mm-hmm. Okay. Were you excited or nervous?
You know, I think everybody was going.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to go. I can't say that I was thrilled about it, but mm-hmm. I knew I had given a talk at a declamatory contest
mm-hmm.
on Hitler, the scourge of Europe, and I knew what a rotten guy he was,
uh-huh.
and I knew we had to stop him.
Yeah, definitely.
So I went.
Had your father or grandfather fought in a war prior
no,
to this?
No, I don't know my grandfather much.
Okay.
So.
Was your mother happy that you were doing this, or sad to have you go? Or?
I mean, she was resigned to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Wow. So you were 19 years old,
yeah.
And what was your training like?
Well, I went to a program called ASTP,
uh-huh.
which was I was supposed to take almost officer's candidate training,
mm-hmm.
infantry training though, with all the weapons, and then after 2 years, I was supposed to get a commission and be doing something with a business degree.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you want me to add to that?
Yeah, you keep going.
Well, that program was going to, I found out, was going to be, I had a stepbrother. My mother had remarried, and I had a stepbrother. Okay. He was in the Army in Alabama, where I was, and he said, he called me and said, you better change your objectives, because that program's going to be discontinued.
Oh, wow.
So then I volunteered for the Air Cadet program.
Mm-hmm.
And I made it. I went to Miami Beach, and I got through all the tests, and and they had me lined up to be a pilot.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sent to the University of Buffalo for four months.
Wow.
And we were trained in navigation, and we got 10 hours of flying. When that program ended,
mm-hmm.
the day it ended, they came, we got a telegram from General Arnold saying, we're the greatest cadets they've ever had, but we don't need cadets, we need riflemen and infantry.
Wow.
So you're going to be transferred to the 78th Infantry Division.
Wow.
Which was a real downer.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was tough.
Had you been prepared to be able to be transferred for that?
No, I didn't. I thought I was going to be a pilot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so then we got some advanced training,
mm-hmm.
and we went overseas.
Wow.
Went to England, and then the fall of 1944, we landed in France.
Mm-hmm.
And then got in, and we had light skirmishes, and but not heavy fighting like we did almost immediately in December in the Battle of the Bulge.
Mm-hmm. What was that like, landing in France and knowing that you're about to fight for the very first time?
That's I didn't have any options.
Right.
Nobody asked me for any advice.
Right. Wow. Did you have anything that you brought from home with you to give you some comfort?
Well, you know, one thing I did, not from home, but mm-hmm. I was a country boy, and
okay.
I was, I guess I'm practical, but and they had the, they put socks out in the, where we were living at the time and moving up towards the front line,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of the GIs didn't take socks, but I had a trench coat, and I had a package of pins I'd gotten from a lady at the USO.
Uh-huh.
So I took every pair of socks I could get,
yeah.
and pinned them inside my trench coat. So it was like a fur coat.
Oh, wow.
And then I had the warmth from that. And then every two or three days I could put on a dry pair of socks.
Uh-huh.
Because we had terrible casualties in the Bulge, mm-hmm. with trench foot.
Mm-hmm.
People had a lot of their feet amputated, and they just turned black, because
wow.
we were wet all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And anyway, yes. So I had those socks, and my feet are all frozen now.
Mm-hmm.
But
still can't feel them.
I have no feeling in my toes.
Wow.
But at least I got them.
Yeah. It's a good way of looking at it.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's what I brought into battle, and
mm-hmm.
Do you want me to elaborate on that, or?
Yeah, yeah. So when you were there at the battlefield,
yeah.
And you had the trenches that you guys were hiding out in, what was it like?
Well, we were in foxholes.
Foxholes, okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's a hole in the ground,
right.
Literally.
Okay.
And I was on a mortar team, which an 81-millimeter mortar team.
Okay.
And I was an ammunition bearer.
Mm-hmm.
And I did that for a couple of weeks or so.
So what did that...
Or a month, maybe.
What did that entitle you to
well,
do?
Well, we had... the Jeeps couldn't get up to the front lines to
mm-hmm.
where we were. So we had to go back, and I had an apron, like a canvas apron that would carry, I could carry six shells in a pocket in
uh-huh.
the front and six in the back. And that's how we got the ammunition up to the gun to shoot it.
Wow.
And I'd just make trips back and forth. And I did that, and we were having really tough times, and my lieutenant, Alan Van Dyke, who was a wonderful man, mm-hmm. came to get me, got me, and said, "I hate to do this, Mitchell, but I got to transfer you to the machine guns because almost all of them are wounded or not living, or evacuated for other reasons." And so I went on a machine gun.
Wow.
And I was there about 2 weeks, and a tank. We're trying to capture a town called Kestranek, mm-hmm. and we couldn't do it. The Germans hung on to it. Mm-hmm. And fought with everything they had, and they had, you know, 200,000 or 300,000 soldiers
wow.
fighting, and we thought we were fighting the whole German army.
Yeah.
And a tank made an evacuation out of the town and almost ran over our gun. We had it camouflaged so you couldn't see it, and our machine gun, and the tank stopped right over the top of us, and mm-hmm. we all had only 3 people on the gun, or 4, and supposed to have 8 to run a machine gun, but we didn't have 8.
Wow.
And we didn't have enough ammunition, and we didn't get maybe one warm meal every 3 days.
Wow.
And we ate K rations, and the tank, we told him how to get back to battalion headquarters, mm-hmm. and the tank left, and the Germans could see all that, and so they saw where we were camouflaged, and about 15 minutes later, they dropped a shell right on our gun, and we were all evacuated to the aid station, but no one was killed.
Wow.
And so we went to the aid station, and I was there a week. I didn't have any serious wounds, but I was wounded.
Yeah.
And
where were you wounded?
Oh, I was my body.
Uh-huh.
You know, I'm just, I was really out of it. Then when Alan Van Dyke came and got us and got me and hauled me to the aid station, and I was kind of out of it and mm-hmm. woke up in the aid station. But I was there about a week, and we couldn't go get to a hospital. They couldn't evacuate us. The Germans were 35 miles in back of us.
Wow.
It was very bad. And then we were fighting, and finally we held the line. We didn't retreat.
Wow.
And then the lieutenant that had hauled me around mm-hmm. took me as his runner. And the communication lines were always being inoperative.
Mm-hmm.
Either the wires, if there were telephones, the wires would be hit by a shell, or the Germans would cut them.
Mm-hmm.
And we had radios, but they didn't ever work. And mm-hmm. so if they had to communicate with battalion headquarters
mm-hmm.
about where we were and what we were doing and what was going on, the platoon leader, Alan Van Dyke, had me he'd give me a message, and he'd say, "Go find battalion headquarters." I didn't know where it was, but I had to find it and deliver the message, and then they'd have a message to give to him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I did, and it was and it did that for most of the rest of the war.
So how were you able to find the headquarters?
Yeah.
Just asking questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
And asking GIs and where it was. And,
mm-hmm.
And then that's what I did. I really had great admiration for this lieutenant. He was like our old man, we call him. He was 22 years old.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he was a graduate of Michigan State.
Wow.
And a wonderful man.
Wow. So when you were working on the machine gun, had you fired a machine gun before?
Oh, yeah. We all been. We trained in all the weapons.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the mortars.
Mm-hmm.
We were trained. One day or 1 week in combat, mm-hmm. you're a veteran.
Okay.
And that's you either learn fast or you're not living.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, it's on the job training, I'd say.
So you were talking about frostbite. People would get that.
Yeah.
What? I mean, is there any way to understand how cold it was there?
I've seen articles published and mm-hmm. temperatures were below zero.
Wow.
Yeah, and it was really cold.
Did it help being from Minnesota bearing the cold?
No, I don't think so. You know, it's like Death Valley. It wouldn't help you any if you had spent a lifetime in Death Valley, it'd still be hot.
Yeah. That is a good point. Good point. And, wow.
And we fought at the Remagen Bridgehead. We were at mm-hmm. the first bridge across the Rhine River.
Mm-hmm.
And we fought there, and I was up. They captured that bridge at 4 in the afternoon, and I was up there at 7 o'clock that night.
Wow.
And then we went across the railroad bridge, mm-hmm. we ran across, and they were trying to blow it up. There were all kinds of German airplanes trying to, so it would fall in the river, in mm-hmm. the Rhine River, and they so that we couldn't get across.
Mm-hmm.
But it lasted about two weeks, and then it fell in the river, and 13 people were killed.
Wow.
Yeah, but that's part of the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Were you ever scared when you were in combat?
I was scared constantly.
Yeah.
I am.
How did you handle that fear?
Oh, I mean, I told my kids, I think I said the Lord's Prayer 100 times a day.
Wow.
And because it's we were in great peril.
Mm-hmm.
And both from the weather and the environment and it was 3 feet of snow,
mm-hmm.
and it was a tough time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, after how many years were you sent back to America once the war was over?
Well, then I fought with my division
mm-hmm.
till. The armistice was, I think it was May, yeah, I think so.
Uh-huh.
And then the Germans capitulated, mm-hmm. surrendered.
Yeah.
And that was, we were in a town called Wuppertal.
Okay.
And I was on duty like a sheriff.
Uh-huh.
Because we had all the Germans to control,
right.
And that it was like being a sheriff around here.
Really.
And two of us ride in jeep and one of the problems is that they had white Russians that had worked for the Germans, uh-huh. and but they the white Russians didn't like the Russians and. And they probably willingly joined the Germans.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't admit that, but then when we after the war, when we had to keep them under control, they mm-hmm. wanted to make a big thing about how much they hated the Germans, and so we almost have to shoot over their heads to calm them down.
Wow!
It was just like being a sheriff.
Mm-hmm.
And then, this is too involved, but then my lieutenant, he was my company commander,
mm-hmm.
in an H company, and he sent me to a college that the military formed in southern France, mm-hmm. at Biarritz, France, mm-hmm. and which was great that I'd been his runner, so that probably helped me. And
right.
And I went to Biarritz, France, got on a train, and
mm-hmm. wow.
And I got down to France, and I had been a one thing I'd done in high school also. I played in the high school band.
Okay.
I played. We had a new band teacher in the high school, mm-hmm. and he needed to build a band in this little high school with 35 in the class. And,
yeah.
and so he got my mother to buy a tenor saxophone, so mm-hmm. I learned to play it, and I had a little talent for it.
Uh-huh.
It's,
wow.
And in the Army, every place I went, mm-hmm. they knew about that. So they'd have a band that wasn't in the organization of the military,
uh-huh.
but it was a band so that they could have dances with the girls at the USO. And
wow.
So I played in two or three bands,
uh-huh.
but not on a permanent basis. I always had to keep my other job.
Right.
And when I got to Biarritz, France,
mm-hmm.
I went with another fellow.
Mm-hmm.
We had played in a show band. We had been a touring show band entertaining the troops, because there were 1.5 million American troops waiting to be involved in the invasion of Japan.
Oh, okay.
And so we put on a vaudeville show,
mm-hmm.
and we were the show band. I played in the show band. And I was in one of the skits.
Wow.
Do you want all this?
Yeah, no, this yes. is great. This is great.
Well,
keep going.
You can cut a lot of it out.
No.
In the skit I was in, oh, that's so silly, but anyway, I was on a skit.
Uh-huh.
And we played in the band. We played all the music. Everybody loved Glenn Miller music.
Mm-hmm.
And, big band music, and we had a pretty good band. But when I got to Biarritz, France, in this school,
mm-hmm.
After the first week, they put a sign up and said they were going to form a big band, jazz band. Harry Yeager, Benny Goodman drummer. Oh, that'd be like Mickey Mantle if you're a baseball player.
Yeah.
And so my roommate had played for a band called Les Brown,
uh-huh.
who Les Brown went to Duke University.
Wow.
And he had played, he was a big time piano player, my roommate,
mm-hmm.
and arranger. So he went to the tryouts, and he said, come on, and I said, I'm not going, I know my limits, I won't be good enough. And he came back and he said, you jerk. he said, I listened to all the tenor sax players and you play better than any of them.
Really?
We're going back tomorrow.
Yeah.
So I did go with him. And I got to play in the band.
Yeah.
And it was a 17-piece jazz band.
Wow.
And we played for the GIs. We'd play an afternoon concert and an evening concert. And they danced with all the French girls.
Oh.
And it was just really something. There'd be 500 people in the dance floor,
mm-hmm.
just crowding the stand and cheering the music, and it was
wow.
it was wonderful.
Wow. Now how, so while you were playing the music and they were
I
dancing.
I was also going to school. I got 15 credit hours.
Wow.
College credit hours were accepted.
Wow. That's
they formed a university.
Mm-hmm.
And had a dean of students from the University of Wisconsin and everything. You know, there were all kinds of teachers in the military. So,
wow.
So then I had enough time to. You went home by the number of points you had, which you would get if you got a decoration. Oh, they gave me a bronze star. I was decorated, and I had 3 battle stars.
Wow.
And I had a combat infantry badge, which I treasure.
Yeah.
That's a badge That's the only badge that's in the Army that's worn above the Congressional Medal of Honor.
Wow.
And it means that you've been in combat and you've been shot at and you shot back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. And I have that kind of, I have some real feelings about that.
Mm-hmm.
They said it took 81 people to support one person and that really got into war. And I was number 82. Yeah, I got right into it.
Wow.
But anyway, so I had to, then to get home, I had to go from the coast of Spain in France,
mm-hmm.
all the way across the continent to Berlin, where my division was on occupation duty with the mm-hmm. Russians and the French and the British. And
mm-hmm.
And I made that trip, and then I got home. And when I got home, my mother was seriously ill.
Mm-hmm.
And she died in 4 or 5 weeks.
Wow.
It was terrible. It was tough, but...
Yeah.
Then I went to the University of Minnesota.
Okay.
Yeah. And they were good to the GIs.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I want to go into the business school. I only had 1 year
mm-hmm.
and supposed to take 2 years of pre-business courses. And I said, well, I've got this the credit hours from the school in France, and
mm-hmm.
and I'll take some tests, and I took GED tests, and I passed them, and so they let me in the business school. They said if you take 4 economic courses and to 2 summer sessions,
mm-hmm.
and you do have good grades, we'll let you in the business school after just 1 year pre-business. And so I did. I made almost all the best grades I've ever had, before or after. I had all A's, I think, and because I really wanted to do that,
mm-hmm.
make up for the time I'd lost. I'd been in service about 3 years, and I went to the University of Minnesota.
So did you meet your wife at the University of Minnesota?
Well, I did, but not until I got my business degree.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was a sophomore in law school, and she was going to Agnes Scott College. It's a school here in Georgia,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And she had one thought she might want to teach mathematics, and so she went to the University of Minnesota to get some. They had to take some history, the history of Minnesota and so on. That's, and they just made them take it.
Uh-huh.
And I knew a fellow from her hometown, and he said, there's a girl, nice girl, and she's in the dormitory. She doesn't know anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So he said, why don't you give her a call? And so I did. I was working for my meals.
Uh-huh.
And I was selling men's clothes, and I was selling stationery and Christmas cards, and taking a full load in school.
So you were busy.
I was busy.
Yeah.
And I didn't have a car. I got a car for about 1 or 2 months
mm-hmm.
when I got home, and I got rid of it. I said, oh, that car is going to eat me up. I'm not going to have it. So I didn't have a car,
mm-hmm.
and I worked at a fraternity house for my meals, and they put me in the fraternity, and they said, in order to work here, you got to be in the fraternity, so we'll let you in, and so I got in the fraternity, and I got my business degree. And I was in a reserve, I was in an Air Force Reserve unit. I mm-hmm. also had a military, I'd have to train 1 weekend a month for the military.
Wow.
And so then I went to law school,
mm-hmm.
and I was a senior in law school.
Mm-hmm.
Then I met Sally, my sophomore year in law school.
Okay.
and we just hit it off. And,
been together ever since.
But then she went back to Georgia to college.
Okay.
And I think I'm probably rambling on.
No, no, this is great. This is great.
And, well, anyway, I took her to a free movie. Oh. And bought her a Coca-Cola. I wasn't on a blind date going to make any big investment. Oh, God. Then I took her swimming, borrowed my roommate's mother's car. Wow. I didn't have a car. I took her swimming to a beach in Minneapolis. And she got an ear infection.
Oh, no.
And she had a lot of boyfriends.
Uh-huh.
She was a popular girl. And so I found out about it almost accidentally. And so I said, God, I need to go take her something.
Mm-hmm.
And she was in the infirmary, which is a hospital for the students.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm on the way driving over there. Some little kids had a stand with, they had cut flowers, and I bought her, I don't know, 75 cents worth of cut flowers. Yeah. And I went up to her room. She got an ear infection. She was not well, but she got better. But God, I went in her hospital room, and it looked like a funeral parlor.
Really?
There, all these boyfriends had all sent her big sprays of flowers. I said, here, my little bouquet. And then, well.
So how long were you guys, did you guys date before you got
married?
Well, then,
yeah, before she went back to, she took me down to meet her family, because I didn't have a family.
Mm-hmm.
One winter I had Christmas, I stayed in the fraternity house. That was a tough time.
I bet.
But anyway, I didn't feel sorry for myself.
No?
So then her mother liked me. I don't know whether her father was thrilled with the idea. I was kind of an alley cat, but... then she went... And then her dad tells the tale. I invited her to come up for homecoming, mm-hmm. like here at Clemson. Mm-hmm. They were going to play Purdue, and I said, if you can make it somehow, just come up for it. And her dad said, you know, she was a senior.
Mm-hmm.
She had been in Agnes Scott 4 years and never called home and said she was homesick. She called her dad and said she was homesick.
Oh.
And her brother-in-law, married to her older sister, had an airplane,
mm-hmm.
had a good airplane, two-engine plane. And he heard about this. He picked her up in Atlanta, flew her to Minnesota, where her parents lived then.
Uh-huh.
And then she came up to university for the weekend,
uh-huh.
for homecoming. It was mm-hmm. a big deal. And then I got her a room in a tea room.
Mm-hmm.
And I had that... His mother's, this my roommate's mother's car, was in a Hudson, pea green Hudson, awful car. It's the only car I had I could have. So I picked her up at the train station. She came up to Minneapolis,
mm-hmm.
and she, I picked her up and she had a little overnight bag and raincoat, and it was raining, and the car battery wasn't working very well.
Uh-oh.
And I had given, and there were two tea rooms in the University of Minnesota,
mm-hmm.
one Smith and maybe say the other is Brown or something, but anyway, I said, I'm gonna take you to the tea room, and the key will be under the mat, and then I'll pick you up for breakfast in the morning. Mm-hmm. And I said, I gotta leave the car running because I'm afraid to shut it down, it won't start. So I dropped her off, and I drove back to the fraternity house. I said, wait a minute. Brown, Smith, oh my God.
Oh no.
I dropped her off at the wrong tea room.
Oh man.
Oh my God. And then I had shut the motor up. I couldn't start the car. There was one other guy in the fraternity who had a car, Jack Akers. He was asleep. I got him by his shoulders and shook him like a rag doll and said, Jack, give me the keys to your car. I'll explain later. And he did. And I went roaring down there and pulled up in front of the tea room, and it had a kind of a southern porch.
Mm-hmm.
And in it, and there she peeked around the corner.
Oh, gosh.
She had made a bed out of the key didn't work, and she made a bed out of her raincoat and rolled something up for a pillow.
Yeah.
Anyway, then I got her to the right tea room, and she didn't fuss with me. She didn't say one unkind word. I really got interested in her then.
Yeah. But she'll put up with you after that.
That's right. Yeah. She'd be, as I say, I was kind of an alley cat.
Yeah.
And then we got married.
Wow.
Yeah.
How long have you been married?
67 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
I didn't have anyone to have the groom's dinner.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have any relatives. Mm-hmm. And I didn't have any money.
Mm-hmm.
So her sister and brother-in-law did the groom's dinner.
Wow.
And then we went. So then that was my senior year in law school. We had lived minimally.
Mm-hmm.
$70 a month rent for an awful place. Share the bath.
Wow.
And we got married, and her mother was in my corner all the time. Her father wasn't a bad guy, but he was a stern man. And
yeah. So how many years after you had been married did you get your notice for Korea?
Well, I don't know if I've been, and it was about a year, because
okay.
I was a senior in law school.
Okay.
And then I was in a ready reserve unit where I got paid.
Okay.
So I had to go. I mean, there wasn't mm-hmm. any deferment for education.
Mm-hmm.
But I was happy. I was broke. I didn't have any money left.
Mm-hmm.
I took a job in law, and it was tough, really tough.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to go to law school and work.
Oh, I bet, yeah.
Yeah, but... I got a job, and then everybody else that got called back up, that was in March. I would have graduated in June. It was on the quarter system. I had one more quarter of courses to take.
Mm-hmm.
But I got called in the service and told to report to Cal. They came in and interviewed
mm-hmm.
and sent me to SAC, to Castle Air Force Base, in Merced, California.
Wow. Was your wife able to come with
you? Well, we had a child by then. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we had a child.
Okay.
Had a little 3-year-old boy.
Mm-hmm.
We put him in the back seat of the car and we drove 2,000 miles to California.
Wow.
And Then I was a first lieutenant, so I got paid $500 a month, which was good money in those days.
Mm-hmm.
And but because I had all that infantry and experience and training, mm-hmm. I was a really good soldier.
Okay.
And so they put me in the legal office, and they had like 2,000 or 3,000 officers, a lot of pilots and everything. At a SAC base, we had atomic bombs and bombers. And the base commander knew about me.
Mm-hmm.
And last year, he made me a special assistant. And I almost stayed in the military.
What made you leave the military?
Well, I didn't have, I would have immediately had to go to Korea.
Okay.
And I didn't have anyone to, I could call and say, take care of Sally while I'm gone. I just mm-hmm. didn't have anybody.
Mm-hmm.
I just didn't think I could do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I had a high efficiency reports.
Mm-hmm.
I'll show them to you.
Yeah.
Well, and so then and I almost stayed and made a career out of it, but things had gone so good for me.
Mm-hmm.
And and then I got out, and then I don't know that I had the passion for the law, but I thought it was, instead of getting a master's degree, I'd go to law school. And that's, another fellow that I studied with in the business school in mm-hmm. Minnesota, he said, well, he didn't know what he went. He said, let's go to law school. I said, okay. And it was kind of that way. And while I was in the military, though, they sent me my degree. That was a wonderful thing to do. So so then I got out and I got into business degrees, and I've had a good business career, too.
So if you could do it all over again, would you do the same thing that you did?
I don't know. I mean, no, I shouldn't. I don't know. Your tender ears would say that. Sally got pregnant pretty fast.
Yeah.
And everybody else was. I didn't. Then we saved 1/4 of our money that we got paid in the Air Force,
mm-hmm.
so we'd have enough money to buy a house when we got out.
Yeah.
And that we did that, and I told the base adjutant, I was a major, I was a first lieutenant, I said, I'll do any job you've got on this base, but I don't want to do a job more than one time because I want it to be a learning experience, and I also want a 3-day pass every month because
mm-hmm.
I'm saving money to buy a house. And he just went along with me.
Wow.
So I didn't take any leave time
because
mm-hmm. I get a 3-day pass every month.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
and then we had $4,000 or $5,000, we could buy a house. Mm-hmm. Not much of a house, but
yeah, it's a house.
A house, anyway.
So based on your war experience, like, did any of your children go into the military?
Yeah, my son went to Vietnam.
Okay.
Yeah, and my daughters. I have 3 daughters and a son.
Uh-huh.
And he went to Vietnam.
How are your feelings of him going to Vietnam?
You know, I'm sorry in a way, but that's what he did, that mm-hmm. and he wanted to do it. And
mm-hmm.
So that's the way that worked out.
Yeah, definitely.
We've raised our children to be independent.
Uh-huh.
And so that's the way that goes. Yeah, I sure rambled on about a lot of stuff here.
No, I really appreciate you taking the time to share this story with us.
Well, that's just about it. And then I went to, I'll tell you what I did.
Uh-huh.
I went to Shelbyville, Tennessee.
Uh-huh.
as a resident manager of a manufacturing plant. Mm-hmm. So I had a good job.
Mm-hmm.
And I had worked in corporate headquarters for 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I went down there and I integrated the first plant in that town to be integrated. And yeah.
Do you remember what year that was?
Sure, 1960.
1960.
And we had a skilled, it was an engraving plant for paper products,
mm-hmm.
graduation invitations and Christmas cards and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't one place in that town that was integrated. It was 40 miles away from where the Freedom Riders were killed.
What kind of response did you receive?
Well, I tell you, I wasn't a great. I passed. I got my diplomas, but
mm-hmm.
but I wasn't a great student.
Mm-hmm.
But I was decent. But I've had to live. Take care of myself for a long time,
mm-hmm.
and I think I got, I got the people in the town together, the lieutenant governor of the state,
mm-hmm.
and the judge, and the important people in the town. And I said, we're going to have some bumps in the road when this all breaks loose,
mm-hmm.
that we're going to integrate the plant,
mm-hmm.
and I said, we're going to do it. Now, if you don't want us on that basis. We got four other towns that want us, and no, they wanted us.
Mm-hmm.
So we integrated it, and I found a black young man that was a skilled printer,
mm-hmm.
and I hired him because we were having to hire people right off the street.
Mm-hmm.
With no training,
mm-hmm.
and I thought he would immediately get a bigger job because he's the only probably skilled one that we had in the plant,
mm-hmm.
and we started with about 50 employees, then about that time the Southern sales manager for the company went with a competitor company.
Yeah.
So the president of the company who had hired me,
mm-hmm.
said, well, he said, you keep on running the plant, but we're going to run the sales force too.
Mm-hmm.
So this was, I had two difficult jobs.
Right.
And I came back to Shelbyville from a trip with working with a salesman, and I had a petition for a labor union.
Oh.
And I'm not anti-labor. I've joined a union, but in my working days. But it's not good for a new plant to have to deal with the union who wanted to tell you how to run the plant,
because
mm-hmm. you make your own mistakes without. So. Mm-hmm. I took them, they ran me against, I had interviewed every employee we hired,
mm-hmm.
and I knew them, and I broke every rule in the book. I don't put this on the tape. I had a visit with each one of them, and we had the election, and beat them 11-1.
Wow.
So that's the last, and that plant is still operating. And now has 500 employees.
Wow.
And three
wow.
shifts.
Wow.
And it's the best place in town to work, and still a non-union plant. And and it's completely integrated.
Wow.
And I had one other thing that happened. They wanted to honor me as a resident manager,
mm-hmm.
and the foreman and
mm-hmm.
the other officers at the plant.
Uh-huh.
And have a big welcome in program for the plant coming there. And they got the high school band, and Andy Holt, the president of Tennessee, we picked him up in the company airplane, and he made the big speech. And but 2 days before the grand opening, Judge Bob Hall called me and said, "I got a problem. We had a black sales manager, Jack LaFleur." And he was there, just like all the other managers, for the, it was a big thing for the opening of the plant. And he said, "We've never fed a meal to a black man in the history of Shelbyville, Tennessee, at the American Legion Club." And he said, "I don't know if we can do it." And I said, "Well, you've helped me every way, and you've been great. And we've pulled this off. So let me think about it." And I said, I came back to him and said, "Well, I was the one they were honoring, but they were honoring all the people, but I was the head guy." And I said, "I won't be at the dinner party." I said, "Jack LaFleur and I are going to have dinner at my home. My wife's going to cook a steak for us."
Wow. What, what was his response to that?
It was fine. He knew what I was dealing with. He and I were good friends. So that's what we did. We got the public relations director of the corporation, and Mickey Humes, and Jack LaFleur, and I, and Sally cooked dinner. And let it go.
Wow.
You know, I've learned in war and in life, don't put so much emphasis on any one problem that you don't win. Yeah, I always worry more about winning the war than in winning the battle. And it was just one thing. We had to make a decision, and I made a decision. And I had wonderful experiences. The head of the black community was Dr. Sidney Harris. He was the school principal, and called it Bedford County Training School. It's a demeaning title. They won't, don't call them in high school. And and I went to see him every Friday afternoon at 2 o'clock. And I sat down and gave him the straight skivvy about what we were doing and how it was working. So that, because you get terrible rumors about things in a situation like that. So I made sure he had the truth and what we were doing, and we got to be wonderful friends.
Good.
And it worked.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's still running.
Still going strong.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I've rambled enough now.
No.
But that's that was a, and I, we hauled our kids to Tennessee. And,
yeah.
And
wow.
And funny things happen.
Yeah, definitely.
Have I talked too much now?
No, I mean, we have plenty of footage, so I was just gonna see if you, if there's any last words or any last wisdom you want to share.
I'm full of it.
So. Yeah.
But we had a funny thing happen in the school. My son was about in the fifth grade, and the fifth grade teacher was from Selma, Alabama, raised on a plantation, and she was tough. And no one got crossed her. In the first day in school, my son is a talker like I am, I guess. They got all the kids in the class lined up by their height. I don't know why she did that, but and she said, "Well, there, I think I got it just right." And he put up his hand, and he said, "No, Mrs. Wright," he said, that guy is taller than the other guy." And she went, "Ooh." And she, our son came home from school, My wife tells me the story, but, you know, and she said, "Well, Georgie, how did it go?"
Yeah.
And she's all smiles, and he's looking at his shoes. He's shaking his head, and he said, "Mama," he said, "I don't think this is going to work." But, you know, she had given a library to the school. She had some money. She had a wonderful school library. He read every book in her library, and they got to be bosom friends.
Wow, right.
Yeah, it's a great story.
That is super funny.
He said, "I don't think this is going to work." Well, anyway, so that's him. And then here I am.
Yeah.
And then, and I'm. Any words of wisdom? What do I think? Oh! Here, I'll get out. I had some people over here from our church that my wife had a wonderful 90th birthday party for me in the Downs. Did you know about that?
Yeah, I knew about it afterwards.
Did you?
Yes.
And I had some extra copies of this Leaving Footprints for One Another.
Uh-huh.
It's got a Longfellow poem on it. Uh-huh. I'll give you a copy.
Okay, that'd be great.
And I'll give you a copy.
I'd love a copy.
Yeah.
And then some things I've kept on in my files. A wonderful article about the Voyagers. This is a Minnesota writer.
Mm-hmm.
Who writes about people going out to the country where the it's all water and bordering Canada.
Oh, okay. Mm.
And and he says, and he just read the last thing. He says, "The elements of danger and chances are wonderful and frightening to experience, and though I bemoan the recklessness of youth, I wonder what the world would be like it without it. I am for the spirit that makes young men," and I should have changed and said young men and young women, I have three daughters, "do the things they do. I am for the glory that they know." That's a great thing. This is a Mormon. The Mormon church used to have sermons on Sunday,
mm-hmm.
and they were great sermons. And this is on work well done.
Hmm.
Yeah. It says, "It's an unhappy day in the life of any man where he fails to find sincere satisfaction in doing useful things for the joy of doing them, and doing them in the best of his ability." It's a wonderful, wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have... I kind of wrote this to my grandchildren, because I have so many of them. But I said, "Get the trash out of your life. That includes caffeine and nicotine and stress. Instead, fill yourself with walking, exercise, vegetables, fruit, music, smiles, friendships, and no stress. Have faith. Faith gives you courage. Share your challenges with your Maker. All things are possible through Christ. Ask Christ to take you by your hand. Love your neighbor as yourself. Plan your life and set goals, then focus on your goals. Always be bigger than your problems. With love, Grandpa." And I said an addendum to it, "In the winter of 1944 in Germany, during the Battle of the Bulge, living in a foxhole and 3 feet of snow, with temperature around zero, out in the open, I developed this creed. If ever again I have a dry place to sleep, with a warm meal in my stomach, and no one shooting at me, I will not complain." Yeah. That's it. Yeah.
Wow, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Oh, well,